Hey guys, we are in the basement. Today we're going to do a John's Arcade tech video, guys. And you know what? We're going to work on that Dragon's Lair. And you're saying, John, what are you talking about? There's nothing wrong with your Dragon's Lair. And you're right, there is nothing wrong. However, I want to upgrade it. I want to improve it. And I want to future-proof it because this game, guys, has a bad reputation. It really does. It's got a reputation of breaking, and right now, fortunately, mine is working, okay? But what we're going to do today is we're going to install a board called the Merlin board, and we're going to install a new, more modern, and more reliable LaserDisc player. And the reason I'm doing this is kind of twofold. Well, one, I want to install that Merlin board because it allows you to have a bunch of different ROM sets on here. You can have Dragon's Lair Enhanced, and you can have regular old Dragon's Lair. And then you can also install a Space Ace laser disc. So I can play Space Ace on this machine at a later date if I ever get the disc. So that's really why I want to do it, because I want to look for a Space Ace disc. And the other thing is, well, you know what? I wouldn't mind upgrading my laser disc player. Mine works fine, though. Don't get me wrong. It's working fine. Sometimes it kind of like, it can't find its way, like it's kind of loading and loading and loading. And hopefully a new LaserDisc player will fix that. And then also, you know, this LaserDisc player that's in here is the original. It's the LV 1000. It's from 1982 or 83, right? It's pretty old. And we're going to put one in that's from the 90s that's actually a really top-of-the-line LaserDisc player. So we're going to be putting a 10-year newer LaserDisc player in here. And it's going to be a little smoother, the transitions when it's, you know, loading the tracks. Because this thing's, you know, basically the laser's jumping all over the disc, loading different sequences. And the more modern LaserDisc players, they were able to do that a little bit more smoother, okay? So that's why I want to put it in there. And also, in this video, I want to install a spectator monitor. And that is a monitor that's going to go on top of the game that is going to show the gameplay exactly as it is on this screen, but for the spectators. Yeah, I know, it's kind of, do I really need that down here? Not really, but it's cool, right? Because in the arcades back in the day, they actually had these spectator monitors where they would put a monitor on top of a game. And then the crowd would gather around as the guy's playing Gyrus, and the crowd could watch the gameplay up top. And so I picked up a monitor that we're gonna use for that. It's a Sony PVM monitor, and we're gonna install that on the top. And what's also nice is that the new LaserDisc player that we're gonna put in has two outputs. So it's gonna make it really easy for us to do that. So let's just kind of review really quick what's going on in the game here. So I got the back door off. So here's the original Pioneer LV1000. And that's a commercial grade LaserDisc player, but it's one of the first ones. You know, it's from 83. Okay, and then here's the original ROM board. And we're gonna replace that with this Merlin board, which will have multiple versions of Dragon's Lair on it, the last official release, and then also this enhanced version that was made by a bunch of guys that actually kind of rewrites how the game plays, the scripting of it. It tries to tell more of a linear story. And then this Merlin board will also have the Space Ace ROMs on it, so we could just put a Space Ace disc in our game. So let's go over to my desk. And by the way, I just spent some time dialing in the monitor. I know at the end of the last Dragon's Lair video, we were trying to adjust the colors, and a lot of you guys told me I got it wrong. And I think I got it right now. It actually looks pretty good. And when it goes to the black screen, it's not red, because I had the red drive up way too high. But anyway, let's go over to my desk here, and let me show you guys what's going on and what we're going to do and the stuff I picked up. So come on over here. All right, so here's the stuff that we're going to be using. So this is a Sony PVM monitor. It's like a commercial-grade monitor. And I got it on eBay for $55 shipped. And this is what we're going to put on top of the Dragon's Lair as a topper. And not in this video. I'm thinking about making like a Dragon's Lair themed frame for it. Like I'll print it out on cardboard or something and put it around here. But for now, this is what we're going to put on top of our Dragon's Lair. And then over here is probably one of the best LaserDisc players that has ever been made. And that is the Pioneer LDV8000, okay? And this thing came out, I think, in 92. So it's about 10 years newer than the one I have now. And this thing was kind of like the Cadillac of Laserdisc players. And it is an industrial grade one. You know, it's one that they would sell like for trade shows or stuff like that, where the thing's running, you know, 16 hours a day every day at a trade show or something. So it's a really heavy duty Laserdisc player. I got this on eBay for $60. Now, I did buy it untested. The listing said that it worked when you powered it on, but they had no Laserdisc or ability to test it. So we're gonna cross our fingers here that this thing actually does work. And then, of course, we have the Merlin board, which is this right here. And by the way, let me show you where you guys can get that, because that's on, there's a guy named Sean Wood, who is kind of like a Dragon's Lair guru, and he's got a website here. It's woodfirst.com, so it's wood1st.com/lasercon. And he's got a bunch of different replacement boards. Now, I'm using the Merlin here, and the Laser Merlin board is two enhancement boards in ones. It's a Laserdisc replacement board, which allows you to use a newer player, which we're going to do. And it's a ROM replacement board, providing two ways to play Dragon's Lair and two ways to play Space Ace. The board's not cheap. It's $150, but, you know, where else are you going to get this thing? And it has two ROM sends for Dragon's Lair. It has the Dragon's Lair Enhanced, and also the final version, which is F2. I'm probably going to use the factory version. I'm not really interested in the Dragon's Lair Enhanced version. The Dragon's Lair Enhancement, it basically, I don't know, it seemed presentation has been restructured in accordance with the original. I don't like that. I really don't. I want my game to play like the original arcade, so we're probably not going to roll with the Dragon's Lair Enhancement. But I am going to probably select the ROM version that is version F2, which is the last factory version. You know, so I definitely want to roll with that. So anyway, this Merlin board allows you to use a myriad of different Laserdisc players. And it says here, you can use Pioneer Models LDV8000, which I have, V4400, V4300, and V4200. And there's also some other ones that are acceptable, the V2200, the V2600, and the V2400. So anyway, this board allows you to plug in a bunch of different Pioneers that are easy to find on eBay, more reliable than the ones that came in the game originally. And so it's just a great board that has gotten a lot of Dragon's Lairs working again. And the fact that it's gonna allow us to use Space Ace down the road is really appealing to me. So, and it wasn't really expensive to get this Super Deluxe Laserdisc player, so I figured, what the heck, kinda have some peace of mind. I'll take the original Laserdisc player out, I'll keep it, I'll put it on a shelf, and that way I still have the original hardware if I ever want to sell the game down the road and the new owner, you know, wants the original equipment, I'll still have it. I'm not going to throw it away or anything. So anyway, I got the board here, I got the instructions, and we're going to just kind of go through here and hook this thing up. And so we need to set the Laserdisc player up, though, to work with the with Dragon's Lair, and he's got some very specific instructions in here how to do that. So why don't I set the tripod up, and let's go through it and set the Laserdisc player up. Okay, so I got the instructions all set. The first thing I want to do, though, is I want to hook up my Laserdisc player to this monitor, and we'll use this monitor to set it up. Now, this Laserdisc player has RCA outputs, okay? The video comes out of the Laserdisc player with RCA cables, and Dragon's Lair over there, the original Laserdisc player used BNC, which is this connector here. And I'm actually wasn't really familiar with that because I was calling it composite in the last video, but I guess technically this is BNC. And so I went to Monoprice and I got a BNC to RCA cable, and it was like $3. Monoprice now has a Amazon store, so I actually ordered this from Amazon, but it was from ultimately Monoprice. So I got a 3-foot cable that we're going to use to hook the Laserdisc player up to the video card in the game, and then I picked up a 12-foot cable that we're going to use to hook the Laserdisc player up to this TV, which is going to be on top of the game. Okay, so right now, though, I'm going to hook And by the way, this TV, this Sony PVM 14-inch TV, has BNC inputs, which again is this right here. So we're gonna use the RCA out on, let me see if I can show you guys the back here of this player. So you could see that this player has video out 1 and 2, and they're both RCA. So we have to convert the RCA to BNC, and this cable is gonna allow it. So I'm gonna go to video out 1, okay? And then we're gonna plug this into the back of the TV because that is the type of inputs that this TV has. I'm calling it a TV. It's actually really just a monitor. And if you look on the bottom here, this TV has actually several kinds of inputs, this monitor. It's got YC in, YC out. I don't know, it kind of looks like S-video. It's got video in, it's got audio in, it's got video out and audio out. And then line B, video in, audio in, and YC in. And if you were using the original LaserDisc player, you could run the video from the LaserDisc player to this TV, to the in, and then on the out, run it back to the game. But I don't have to do that because my LaserDisc player now is gonna have two outputs. So I'm gonna go ahead here and we're gonna hook the LaserDisc player up to this. Okay, so now we're ready to turn everything on and get our LaserDisc player set up. And again, you know, this is a commercial LaserDisc player, so it's got a myriad of settings and options. Okay, so let's turn, tripod's falling. Let's turn on the LaserDisc player, and let's turn the TV on, okay, the monitor. So the monitor's on, so now let's turn the LaserDisc player on, okay? And let's see if anything comes on the screen. So actually, let's read our instructions now. Okay, so for the LDV8000, connect your player to a TV, press and hold the display button while powering on the player. Okay, I didn't do that, so I'm gonna turn it off. And over here, there's a button that says display. I'm gonna hold that in and then turn on the player. And okay, now we're in the setup menu. And I don't have a remote control for this LaserDisc player, which actually had me a little worried, but I guess it doesn't matter because we can access everything using the buttons on the device. Okay, so it says, press scan forward to reach page 5, okay? So let's press scan forward, page 1, 2, 3, 4, okay. All right, and it says here, RS232 switch P5, yep. Verify the baud rate is 4800. It is not, okay? It needs to be no parity, one stop bit, data length 8 bits. So we need to change the baud rate to 4800. And I'm not really sure how I do that. Let's try this. No. Oops. Okay, so let's try this again. I'm pressing the still step button. All right, so how do I change it? Oh, I pressed left. Okay. So there we go. So what I did was I pressed left on the still step button to change the setting. Okay, so now it's set to 4800 baud. Good. Okay, press scan forward and, oh. So baud rate needs to be 4800. Parity needs to be no parity. It is. One stop bit. Data length 8 bits. Good. To make changes, press step forward to highlight. Okay, press scan forward to reach page 6. Okay. All right, so now it says here, verify TXD Terminator, CR it is. And it looks like that's it. We're all set up. Oh, other settings. Okay, memory control, page 7. Let's go there. The LDV8000 has the ability to hold and freeze the last displayed frame of video during a search operation, thereby eliminating the blackout screen between scene searches. Some people prefer this mode, while others consider it a change from the original feel, okay? For original blackout searches, video memory mode control disable. Okay, I want it set up original, okay? I don't want to change the way the game feels, so I'm going to roll with the original way. Okay, I see. So, oh, I get it. So, basically, what this thing can do is, as it's switching to the next track or whatever, instead of going to a black screen, it actually captures the last frame of the image while it does its search and then it loads. So you don't really ever see a black screen because it freezes that last image and then it does its change in the background and then when it's ready, then it starts playing again. Oh, I get it. But I want the original blackout searches. That feels like Dragon's Lair. I don't wanna change the feel of this game any at all. I still want it to be clunky, you know, but I would like a more modern, reliable Laserdisc player for sure, though. So, okay, anyway. Video memory mode. Control disable. Yes. Auto memory off. Okay. All right. So, let's do that. It doesn't say anything about this, though. Frame. Oh, shit. Go back.
What your mark?
Let's go back down here. What is this frame memory? Okay, it doesn't matter, I guess. So let's go to auto memory off, okay? For freeze frame searches, video memory mode, control, enable auto memory on. Okay, so we have video memory mode, control, disable, and then auto memory off. And it doesn't say anything about memory select, probably because if it's off, it doesn't matter. Okay, that's it. And then it says press display to save your settings and exit. So I'm going to press display. Okay, so we should be all set up now. So the Laserdisc player is set up for Dragon's Lair. So now we can start hooking all of this stuff up. So why don't we go to the game? I'll set up the tripod over there and let's get to work. Okay, I'm going to turn the game off, obviously. You don't want to do this with the game on. So let me just kind of spin the game a little bit so we can get to the Laserdisc player. And this thing's really nice because it has this drawer that pulls out. Now, I already removed the wing nuts. There's some wing nuts on the inside here that you have to undo. I've already removed those. So just if you're doing this for the first time, I actually never put them back in when I took it apart last time. So just be aware that there's some wing nuts in these two corners. There's one over here, one over here. And then after you remove those, this slides out like so. Actually, we're going to have to apply a power to this again because I need to get the laser disc out of there because we're going to be putting it in our new player. So let's see if this power cord will reach, and it won't. Turn this a little bit. Oh, shit. All right, I need to get some kind of extension cord or something then because I need to apply power to the game. Let me see if I can move the game a little closer to that power cable. See if that'll do it. Nope. And no. All right, let me get an extension cord. Ugh. Okay, I have an extension cord here, so I'm gonna go ahead here and we're gonna apply power. I'm gonna press the eject button to get the disc out. Okay, now we can turn it off. That's it. All right, so I'm going to take the disc out, and we're going to go put it in our new player. Let's go over to... Actually, this would be a good time to test out the new player, too. Didn't even think of that. All right, so let's go over to the desk. And... Okay, so let's... All right, so let me turn this on. And this is a drawer style guy. All right. Okay, so let's put our disc in here. Let me close it. All right, let's get power back to that monitor. Okay. I'm gonna have to plug this back in. Okay. All right, so... Okay, so let me press play. And let's... Hopefully this Laserdisc player works, because if it doesn't, we're dead in the water, guys. Come on. It says play. It's flashing play. Don't tell me this Laserdisc player doesn't work. It does. Is it working? Oh, good. Okay, so the LaserDisc player works. Awesome. Isn't this pretty cool, though? So when you play the LaserDisc player, it's playing track. So we're going to see the whole... We can see the entire game like this. Because the game is essentially just picking all these different tracks, you know? And if you just put the disc in a player, it just plays one track after another until the game's over. So, pretty awesome. Okay, good. The LaserDisc player works. That is fantastic news. Okay, so now we could turn this off. I'm going to press... Is there a stop button? There isn't. How do you turn it off? Huh. There's a still button. What does that do? Oh, wow. That must have blew people's minds back then to get such a good pause. Because remember, like, VHS tapes, when you pause them, you could rarely pause it where the picture was clear, because you'd always get like these goofy lines or something. But with LaserDisc and DVDs later, you could always just pause it and it would be crystal clear every time. All right, good. Okay, so I'm going to turn this off. LaserDisc player works. That's awesome. That's a major hurdle, actually, because I was a little concerned that it might not work, and it does. So, thank Jesus. All right, so let's go back to the game, and we're going to get the old LaserDisc player out, and just start hooking up our Merlin board. Okay, so I'm going to come in here now and just basically disconnect everything, and we're gonna pull this beast out. And there are a bunch of connections here on... If you guys watched the pickup of this game, we kind of showed them in detail, but there's a bunch of connections on this side, and I'm basically just gonna disconnect them all. And we've got two RCA plugs right here. We've got this ribbon cable that comes out right there. There's the BNC video connection, and then there's the power. Oh man, we're gonna have to make a power plug. Just realized that. I don't know if I have a 2-pin Molex like that. That's okay, we can improvise. I might cut this. Do I wanna cut it though? All right, I just hit a little bit of a hiccup here. I need to find me a 2-pin monitor style Molex like that. Actually, it's an amp connector. Alright, I gotta look around, because we're gonna have to make... Because the power is right here, and we're making our power connection. It doesn't have like a wall plug, it's got these this kind of amp dealy. So let me pull this out. And I need to go search around my parts to see if I have that connector. And I'll be right back. Okay, I actually went and found a connector. I stole it from a monitor in the garage. But, okay, so we're gonna have to basically... The one thing, though, is that this has a ground plug, which means we're gonna have three wires to deal with, and this is only two, so we have a choice here. Do we disregard the ground? Do we just blow it off? I'm kind of tempted to say yes. Let's see what happens when we get in here. So I'm gonna make sure the cord is long enough. I'm just gonna go, yeah, about that. This is a heavy-duty cord, man. Obviously, make sure the game, the LaserDisc player is unplugged before you do this. I wonder if I could, if this would work. Yes. Okay, so we've got three wires. The black, the white, and the green. So let me strip some of the sheathing back. And I really have to decide what I'm going to do about this ground wire. Technically, we should be using it, and I gotta think about it, because I can tap into the ground that's on
your mark.
Because the power that goes into the game with that little PC style power connector, it has a ground. There's a ground there. I could tap in there, and I probably should, just to do this right. Because the old player did not have any kind of ground. Alright. Okay. Okay. So let's strip these wires back. And the ground we're going to address in a minute here, but
on your mark.
Trim these back so they're about an eighth inch long, black and the white. Okay, so I have my amp pins. Man, this is heavy duty stuff, man. Okay, so let's use our crimper. Thank you, Buffett. This thing is the gift that just keeps on giving. Alright, so let's... Boy, that's some fat wire, man. I think I need more wire here. This wire is so heavy, it's not actually reaching. I think I'm gonna strip it back a little further. So I get more wire in there. Because the rubber sheathing on this wire, it's not getting in there.
On your mark.
So let's grab more of the copper. So we got one crimped on there. And we're using a Molex crimper to do these amp connectors, and I'll show you how this works. There's an A and a B. This is the Molex HTR2445A, okay? And what you do is you take your little... Okay, so we're using the Molex HTR2445A to make our crimps. And how it works is you take your pin, okay, and you put it in the A, like so. And the A is pretty much what you use for most of these pins that you deal with on arcade games. And we basically want to then just put our wire in here with the rubber sheathing just barely in it, and then you crimp it down, and then that's it. And there's your crimp. All right, so those are ready to go into the amp connector. I'm not going to put them in yet. Now I need to think about how to handle this ground wire. I'm going to go look at the game really quick and see if I could tap in somewhere with this and figure out a way that we can make it so you can disconnect it too. Okay, I found a spot where we're gonna grab ground. Now this game originally had a PC style power plug that goes right here, and the center prong here is ground. And if you look in the back, it goes to these green wires, okay? So we're gonna tap into this for our ground line on the power plug on the LaserDisc player. Now I probably could get away with not doing this at all, but I might as well since it's gonna be pretty easy to do and it's right here. So we'll just tap into this, run it to the ground on the AC plug on the LaserDisc player, and then, you know what, we can kind of sleep at night knowing that it's properly grounded the way it was intended with the three-prong plug and all that good stuff. So, all right, let's go back over here and let's get everything all ready again for the cabinet. I actually went to Radio Shack today when we cut away, and I picked up a little Molex connector that we're going to use for the ground. So we're going to use the two-prong connector that's in there for the hot and the neutral, which is the black and the white wires here. And then we're going to make another connector that we're going to use for our ground that's going to go to those green wires I just showed you. So I'm going to go ahead and just crimp this on here. And I got this at Radio Shack. It's just a two-position Molex, but we're only going to use one of the positions. So, and again, we're going to take our handy crimping tool here, and we're going to go on A, like so. And then let's go ahead and put our ground wire in here. Okay. And I think that's good. Oh, that's interesting. This is a little different. This one has like another crimp right here, I think. Let's see. Nah, maybe not. Shit. Not sure if I did that right, but we'll find out. I wonder if I should put that in the B. I don't know if these Radio Shack ones are kind of like off-brand or something. You know what? I'm gonna have to redo that. I did it wrong. All right, let me get another one of those. So this thing only came with two of these. Yeah, it's the same. It's got the two positions. Hmm. Let's try it again. Yeah, it's the same. I don't know why, it just didn't crimp right. It didn't look right to me. So let's put this in here. Okay, much better. All right, so we got our and by the way, I'm gonna use the males on this side because the game has females right now. And I purposely put the female here just so I can't mix these up somehow. Okay, so let me bring the LaserDisc player over to the game, and let's make our connections, put our amp connector on, put this on, and then tap into that ground. Okay, so I'm gonna get my ground wire ready here. I'm gonna unplug this, and I went to Radio Shack and I got a new plug. And, oh shit, so what we're gonna do is, we're gonna cut the wires off this and add a third wire that's gonna go to our player. Just want to make sure this fits right. Okay, and I got a slightly bigger one. This is for heavier gauge wire. This is what, for 14? What's this for? This is for 16 and 14 gauge. So I got a fatter one so we can get three wires in there, and I think that's actually the one that was here. So I'm gonna go ahead and cut the old one off. Okay, and then we're gonna strip those wires back, and then we're gonna add a new wire that we're gonna then run to the LaserDisc player. So I'm gonna come in here and see if we can hopefully strip this. It's kind of tight.
On your mark.
Okay. One. This is really tight, man. There's not a lot of slack in the wire. Okay, good. All right, so we got those two stripped. Let me get my new wire. Okay, so we're just gonna tie all three of these together, and hopefully I can jam these in this. Or if I should solder this. Okay. Now we're gonna come in here with our new one, like so. Mm-hmm.
On your mark. Get set.
So hopefully that works. Let me get my crimper here. Okay. Is it in there? It's not. Probably should have got an even bigger one. I wonder if I should solder these together. That way I know for sure that they're all connected. Because this is just like a big wad of wires that I'm trying to crimp together. And if I solder it, I know for certain that they're all going to stay together. Yeah, let me grab my soldering iron. I'm going to throw just a dab of solder on there just to really make sure. Okay, I grabbed my soldering iron. I'm just gonna throw just a little dab of solder on there. I don't want to make this so fat that I can't get it in that spade connector. Just enough to really just hold them together. That's good. So now I don't have to worry about, you know, the bunch coming undone. Okay, so let's grab one of our connectors. I probably should have got the yellow ones, which are for even fatter wire, but whatever. We'll have to make do with the blue guys. Okay. I hope this can get in there. If not, I'll just solder this right to here. Not ideal, but not permanent. I'm not going back to the store. All right. Let's see if we can get this to stay on here. Nope. You know what? I think we're just gonna solder it right to here. Cause the three wires just are not gonna fit in here. Yeah, that's not going in. You know what? I'm just going to solder it to this. And then if I ever want to change it to a quick connect, I can just get one of the yellow quarter inch spade connectors. But this is definitely going to work. It's going to need a lot of heat. Yeah, screwdriver. It's on there. Not ideal. Not hideous, though. It's okay. That's good. Now we can run our ground wire down. Okay, so we're gonna basically snake this around. I got some zip strips here. If you guys can see, so what I'll do is I'll zip strip this to here. Now it'll just pop out here. It'll look pretty original. All right, let me grab the player and some zip strips, and we'll do that. Okay, I'm just gonna come in here and just zip strip the green wire here
to the harness that's just hanging here. So, and then over here. Okay, good. So now we've got that there. So let me get the soldering iron out of the way. Okay, so we got our green wire all snaked around. I have it zip stripped here. This is the original power cable that goes to the laser disc here, our hot and neutral. So I'm gonna go ahead and cut this green wire essentially to the same length as those. And let's go ahead and strip that guy. Okay, so now on our laser disc ground, we had a female. So let me crimp a male pin on there. That way we're ready then for the Molex that we're gonna use to make our ground connection. Okay. I'm gonna trim that back a little bit. So we're all ready now to make our connections. We're gonna have to lose the original video cable because I have a new one that is RCA to BNC. The original was BNC to BNC. So if you look back here, the video cable connection comes to this little converter board here. So we're gonna undo that, okay? And it looks like I'm gonna have to snake the video cord a little differently because Mono Price had 3 feet and 12 feet. And you know, I think I'm just gonna leave the original one in here. I think that would be a good idea. There's no reason to remove it. Let's just keep the original in there. So if we ever wanna convert it back, we can. Okay, so now, okay, so now let's bring our new LaserDisc player over. And this one, not as big, but as heavy. God damn, that thing's heavy. All right. And I have the disc in already. And obviously it doesn't line up to the feet, to where the feet were on the old one, but that's okay. Is this thing deep? It is. All right, so now we have to make our connections. Let me get the instructions and let's figure out what to do. Actually, let's make our power connection now because that I know how to do without the instructions. So here's the old plug and here's our ground. So let me get our connectors. Here's the Molex one. All right, so let's do the ground one first. And we'll take, so I'm gonna take this and just pop this guy in here. Okay, so now let's take the player end and gotta make sure I line these up. So it's gonna go on this side. Right? Yeah. Okay. So our ground connection's made. And it's nice and neat. So now let's get our connector for that, which I left on the desk, I think. Let me go grab that. Okay, so we gotta line up our neutral and our hot. The black is hot. And the white is neutral. So the plug is gonna go on like this. So that means black goes. Yep, black's gonna go on this side here. Definitely don't want to mix these up. Okay. Is that okay? I want these gone. I used the wrong size pins.
On your mark, get set.
I think I used the wrong size pins on these. Yeah, these don't want to go to in. All right, let me go see what other size male pins I have. Okay, I think I use 0.084 amp pins, and I think it's 0.093 molex. So I think I used the wrong ones. I always get these confused. They look almost identical. Now this one in here is stubborn, so I've got a pin extractor. So hopefully this will work. You just kind of put it over it and then pull the wire out. If we get lucky here, this will come out. Yeah, okay, just like so. So this little pin extractor goes over this, and it kind of pushes in the little barbs, and you can pull the wire out. So I'm gonna have to recrimp this with the correct using the correct pins. I think these ones are 0.094. I don't know. I get them all mixed up. They all look the same. Bob Roberts sells a little kit, and that's what I have. And I always just steal them from there. And it's actually a great kit. And it's lasted me like a year of crimping stuff. And it's a great little Molex starter kit. It's got all the Molex and some of the amp pins in it. And I really recommend it. In fact, I'm probably gonna order another one. And what's also nice is it has those keys. Remember the keys we on the Journey? The keys are the thing that kind of block the holes on those Molex connectors with the 0.156 pins. So let's come in here.
Get set.
Try this again. Okay. There's one. Let's get our next one. Okay, good. Alright, so now we're ready to try this again. So this goes on here like this, and we've got, let's see, black goes on this side. That feels a lot better. Yeah, those are the right pins. Okay, good. Alright, so there, we got our power hooked up, our power and our ground. Let's double check. Black is going to black, white is going to white. We have our green going to our ground, that's over there. So all of our power is hooked up now. So now we need to hook up the LaserDisc player, the video and the audio. And I'm gonna grab the instructions and let's do that. Actually, we gotta install that Merlin board too. Okay, I looked over the instructions really quick and it's pretty straightforward here. We need to get the old ROM board off, which is right here. And basically we're gonna remove the ribbon cable, okay, which is this guy right here. All right, and then there's just four screws holding this thing on. And it's gonna come in here and unscrew it. Is it gonna be that easy? Because the screws goes all the way through. Let's see here.
On your mark.
What's happening?
Get set.
I might have to pull the whole thing out because this screw is just spinning.
I'm wondering if there's a nut on the other side here that we're gonna have to take a look at. So this is the display. Huh. Yeah, there's a nut on the opposite side there, so I'm gonna have to actually pull this whole thing out because it's not gonna come off. So, let's see, this thing slides up, right? There's a screw locking it in place. Let's think about how we're gonna do this. So let me get this out of the way. That's actually pretty nice. So, let's disconnect. Let me come in here, take a peek. So I want to disconnect basically everything, I think, and slide this board out, because we're going to have to do this on the bench, I think. So we've got this one cable right here that I just removed, okay? And then this one right here, which is for the display board, okay? And then there's this one right here, okay? So it's all disconnected now. So I should be able to just remove this ground screw and then we can slide the whole board out. Here's basically the brains of this game. Okay, so we gotta get this board off. And that's why it wasn't coming off, is because there's nuts on the back and they're just spinning. So let's take that off. They're just hand tight here.
On your mark. Get set.
Okay. Let's see if we can break. Ah, dog, I got the whole. Get the camera zoomed in too much. Sorry about that. So, on the bottom here, there's nuts. Okay, and so just gonna, might have to get my nut driver. There we go. And the reason we couldn't get it off while it was on is because the nuts were just spinning. Okay. And there's little standoffs here, so we gotta just keep track of all this stuff. Alright, so here's our old ROM board. So we're no longer going to use that. I'm going to keep it though. I'm definitely not throwing any of this stuff out or selling it. I'm keeping everything. So that way, if another collector wants this game down the road, you know, who knows? 10 years from now, I get rid of this thing. I want to make sure I keep everything original. I have all the original parts stashed away. Okay, so this. Let's put our screws in here. Need our plastic guys, like so. This is actually not going to be that easy, is it?
Get set.
I really should be doing this on my desk. That one. Let's see. All right, I got all four of them through. Okay. And if you look, there's two plastic standoffs here. There's one on the bottom, one on the top. Make sure the screws are going through all of them. Okay. So now I'm going to come on the bottom here and start threading these nuts back on.
On your mark. Get set.
Just really got my hand on the nut on the bottom side. Okay. So now we got it on and we're ready to put it back in place. So let's go ahead and slide it back in. Actually, I should probably put the ribbon cable in here while I got it out. So that plugs in just like so. Okay.
On your mark. Get set.
Okay, that's where it was. And let's go ahead and screw our ground screw back in. Just kind of holding it in place. Okay. All right, so that's back in. So now, what I want to do is I want to make all my connections again. Now, he included a new ribbon cable. I'm guessing this is an upgrade or I'm not sure why he included this. Oh, I see why. Because the old one, let's see. Oh, I see. So the old one was for a different interface on the LaserDisc player. I get it. Okay, so we're gonna replace this ribbon cable that goes to the LaserDisc player because the old one was using a different scheme. Looks like all together. Okay. Well, that's interesting. Let me see here. Okay. Disconnect the 40-pin, reverse the process. Okay, set dip switches on the main board. We'll do that in a second. Install the replacement. Remove and save the original. Install the replacement cable. Please notice the orientation of the photo. Okay. All right, so let's get the old one out of here. And it goes, so you can see in the photo, the ribbon cable goes away from that transistor.
Okay, I see. All right, so it goes on here like so. It's kind of a tough spot.
On your mark. Get set.
Probably should have connected this when I had the board out. Okay, so that's on. If you guys can see, it's a really tight spot. I'm having a hard time showing you guys everything. But, alright, so that appears to be correct. Let me just kind of come down here with the light and double check. Make sure there's no pins hanging out. No, there's not. Okay, and the ribbon cable goes away from this transistor towards the board. That's how he shows it in his drawing. Yep. Okay, so now we gotta reconnect the LED display right there, okay? And I need to plug back in this guy. Okay, that's really it.
What, your mark?
Don't want to push on the board. Okay, so everything's connected now. Let's just review. First, connect the control video and audio cables to the player. Let's do that. All right. Man, that's really hot today, man. I'm sweating like crazy. All right, let's come over here. And let's make our connections. I wonder if I should spin the LaserDisc player. That actually might make more sense. Yeah, let's see what happens. Okay. Alright, so let's make our connections here. We've got this right here for the controller. And that's going to plug right in here. I believe. Yep, like so. And it's got little screws on it. We got our power. Here's our sound. So we're going to have to look on the back of the player here. So, one. Okay, so it's his bottom two. I'm kind of worried that there's not enough room here. Okay, so this is tight. I think I should maybe spin the player. If I do this, is that better? Yeah, I think so. Okay, so now I gotta make my connections back here. I think that should be fine. There's enough slack in here. Everything to reach, yep. I think we're gonna put it in there like that. Okay. How's that look? I think that looks pretty good. It's so tight in there, man. It's just like the camera's in my way. So I need to make my video connections and my audio connections, which I don't know how I'm going to show you guys. I'm going to come in here and make the connection. And let's see if we can bring the camera down in here. So if you look in here, okay. Okay, so there's our audio is right here. Okay, and then our video is down here, the yellow. So the red and white, the ones on the right is one and two. So I'm gonna go ahead and plug my audio into that. And then I'm gonna plug my video cable into one of the yellow ones there. So that's kind of what I'm doing. It's pretty self-explanatory really, because everything's pretty clearly labeled in there. But
You're not gonna be able to see me when I do it. God darn it, I need a light. Okay, I went to hook up the video cable and I bought this new 3-foot BNC to RCA cable and it's not long enough. So I had to run out to Radio Shack. So we're gonna reuse the old cable. Now the old cable is BNC to BNC. So both ends have the BNC connector, which is not good because I need BNC to RCA. So I went to Radio Shack and got an adapter. So this is a BNC to RCA adapter. And so it's gonna allow me to use the old cable with the new LaserDisc player. So I'm just gonna come down here and we're just gonna stick this guy on here. And there you go. So it's converted our old cable to RCA. And I need to make my connection back up here. So let me put this back in here. So we are gonna keep the old cable. Oh well, I was kind of hoping to put all new cables on here, but I don't know why Monoprice doesn't have a 6-foot cable. I'll look around. We might upgrade the cable later. Who knows? It's not really necessary though. Okay, so let me make the video connection down here. It's just really tight. And the video is this one. Okay. All right, so we're all connected, and I should screw down the connector there that is for the controller. I really should screw that down, but and while I got this out, I'm gonna hook up my 12-foot cable. This is the one we're gonna use for the video that's gonna go to the external spectator monitor, and I think I'm gonna run it through the filter actually to the top of the game. So I'm just gonna hook this up just so it's ready to go when we get to that point. And it's cool because this new LaserDisc player has two outputs. So we're gonna send one to the game, and then one to our spectator monitor on top. Okay. All right, we're all hooked up here. So the only thing that's left to do is to check the dip switch settings. And I should also tighten this down. I need to get a little screwdriver. You know what? Let me go get a small screwdriver. I'm going to tighten down that controller cable. So this little controller cable that plugs in the back of the disc player has these little screws. They're standard screws, and we probably should just tighten it down so it's a nice positive connection. That's good. Okay, so now we're ready to start thinking about the dip switch settings. And I have some thoughts about that because I want to put it on hard. I don't know if it is on hard or was on hard, but I want it on hard. And one thing to keep in mind though, when you install this Merlin board, the factory dip switch settings don't apply anymore. The whole dip switch scheme is thrown out the window. And you have to use his new dip switch scheme. And so let's look here. We've got to have dip switch 7 on to enable the ROM selection menu. Okay, so we got to do that. So I think I'm going to slide the player in. Yeah, let's slide this in so I can get to the ROM board. And let's keep our external cable there. Hopefully this all...
On your mark.
I got my multimeter underneath here. So let's slide it all in. Just make sure all the wires are getting under the drawer. And... oh, wait. This isn't good here. I gotta feed this. This is all tangled up in here. Let's take a look here. Okay. Oh, man. Let's see. I don't like how this is tangled up around this PC.
Okay. That's good. That's good enough for now. I don't like how this ribbon cable's wrapped around the video cable. Should I disconnect this real fast? Okay, so I need to reconnect the controller cable here. Get some light. Spot here. Can't really see. Let me come in here. Use the camera to kind of help me. Okay. There we go.
On your mark.
Okay, I think that's good. Okay. All right.
Okay, we're ready to set up the dip switch settings. And basically, the Merlin board dip switch settings are, they replace the factory dip switch settings. So basically there's an entirely new dip switch scheme with this board. The reason for that is because the dip switches now have to satisfy four different games, okay? We have Dragon's Lair Revision F2, which is the last factory version. We have the enhanced version, which is kind of like a fan-created version of the game that has different scripting. And then we have Space Ace, the last factory version, and then also the enhanced version, which is, again, a fan version. So what you need to do is you need to fill out this table with dip switch settings that are going to satisfy all four versions for your game. And I went through here and really just focused on the Dragon's Lair versions. And I think I'm gonna set mine up for what I think is the factory default settings, which is three Dirks, three guys, three lives. And then the game starts on easy, and then after you clear five levels, it goes to hard. And as far as I can tell, that's the factory default settings. I looked online all over the place, trying to figure out if there's some kind of like standard settings that everyone can agree on, and I couldn't find it. So I'm gonna go through here and set up my dip switches. It's in a tight spot, but I should be able to do it. And also on the board, the dip switches are right here. On the board, I guess the dip switches are labeled wrong. You could see that on the actual part itself, they're labeled 1 through 8, but on the board, they're labeled 0 through 7, okay? And you're supposed to follow the board. We're gonna use 0 through 7, not 1 through 8. So I'm gonna have my cheat sheet here, and let's do switch bank number B first. And it's gonna be off, on, on. Off, on, starting at 0, okay? And it already is, okay? So off, on, okay, that's good. We got that already. And then it goes 1, 2, 3. Actually, everything is on except for 0 and 5, okay? So let's come in here.
On your mark.
I have to get a small screwdriver here. See what I got.
Yeah.
So everything should be on except for 0 and 5. I hope the camera's getting this because I have no idea. I'm holding it with my left hand. Alright, so let me see. Everything's on right now, so this is 7, 6, and then 5. Okay, so everything is on except for 5, okay? And then, okay, now for A, 1, 2, 5, 6, 7 are all on. So when, man, I can't see shit. This is so awkward, man. I should have done this when I had the board out. 5, 6, 7 are on, okay. A. So 5, 6, and 7 are on. 3 and 4 are off. And then 7, 6, 5. So 3 and 4 are off. Okay. 3 and 4 are off. And then 1 and 2 are on and 0 is off. Okay, so off. On. On. Okay. All right. That should do it. So we got, so I have 7, 6, 5, and 1 and 2 are on. Let me double check my sheet. So 7, 6, 5 are on, and then 1 and 2. Okay. All right, I got everything set up. Now it does say in here that B7 needs to be on the first time you turn the game on, because that's gonna force a menu that's gonna make us choose our ROM version. And I have it on. And then after you choose your ROM version, you could turn that off, and it will then always load that same version. So, all right, let's plug this thing in. This better work. Let me get my cable here. This wasn't really hard. You know, you get so sick of just crunching over in a cabinet, though. All right, guys, here we go. Let's plug it in and see what happens. Hopefully nothing blows up. Nothing's happening. Let me check my power cable here.
On your mark.
Okay, I figured out what was wrong here. I didn't have the LaserDisc player on. There's a button in the bottom right here. It's got to be clicked in. So let's see what happens now. Hopefully that does it. And let's just double check. LaserDisc player is on and running. Huh, I still have one light there though. Oh, okay, good. Okay, good, 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 good. All right, it's working. Oh, shit. All right, so let's see. Nothing on the screen yet, though. If you remember when we tested the LaserDisc player before, it took a while for it to scan and then play. And I don't know if that's the player or if that's just the way this works. It's flashing play. Let's take a look here. Nothing on the screen.
I'm hoping it's just loading here. Gonna let it go, I guess. I mean,
on your mark.
Let's see. Program run. It's flashing play. Power lights on. Got neck glow. I hope this player's not bad. I mean, we did test it. It was working. I mean, should I try pressing the play button? Let me see. Let's try turning it off. Oh, man, I hope this stupid LaserDisc player isn't bad. On the screen, it says select ROM set. Okay, factory version. It says 215SE.
On your mark.
All right, I'm just gonna let this go for a couple minutes and see what happens. Alright guys, I got it. And what did I do? I don't really know. I went back into the menu on the thing, and I reset the EEPROM, which is an option on here, basically clearing, I think, the settings. And then I turned it on, and now it's working. And let me show you though, it does take a while for this thing to start, and I don't know. Alright, let's turn it off, okay? And by the way, yeah, I hooked up the external monitor just so I could see the menu when I was back here. It's actually really handy to have that. So, all right, so we turn it on, right? Okay, now watch this. So the thing, it's blinking play, okay? And then on the TV, it says that. And now it parks the disc. It wasn't doing that before. So I don't know what was up with that. Maybe I ejected the tray and then closed it, and that might have fixed it. Maybe when I was moving it, the disc got kind of messed up. I don't know. But now it's starting. See, it's flashing play. It does take a good 30 seconds, though, before we get a picture. And I don't really know if that's normal for a LaserDisc player. I know that this original one, though, took a long time for that to boot up, too. So maybe that's just how long it takes a LaserDisc player to start. I don't know. I'm going to research it. There it goes. So it's about a good 30, 45 seconds to boot. I'm thinking that's normal because that's what that one was doing. So maybe you guys out there that have LaserDisc players know. I don't know because I've never owned a LaserDisc player. I kind of skipped that part of the technology, but it's working. Our display works. The game works. So that was a success. The one thing I do want to do, though, I want to check out the enhanced ROM, because this is the standard ROM, which is easy. It starts out easy and then gets progressively harder. By the way, that picture looks great. Pretty awesome. So I want to turn it off. And then we're going to select the other ROM version, okay? Let's do that. So let's turn it off. Let's turn it on. Let's come up front. Okay, let's select the enhanced version. There we go. Enhanced. Let's see what that's all about. Turn the light off. I probably should get the tripod, but... Yeah, let me grab that real quick while it's booting. Okay, so it booted up into the enhanced version, and let's give it a try here, because we're going to see the drawbridge scene, which got cut from the game. So this is like a re-scripted version, reordered. Okay, so I don't even know. See, I remember doing the drawbridge. I absolutely freaking remember that scene, without a doubt. See, the story here is that they took the drawbridge scene out because if you died on it, you had to keep doing it over and over again. I don't even know what to do. And then basically, your whole game would take place on that stupid drawbridge, but if you die twice on it, then it lets you in. Okay, I see. Oh, wow. I just died. That's it. I had the game set to 3 lives now, which is going to be quite challenging, actually, which is what I want. I want the game to be hard down here. So anyway, this drawbridge scene. Yeah, I don't know what to do. I want to tell you guys about the drawbridge scene, though. I'm trying to figure it out, though. So the drawbridge scene, I vividly remember from... I vividly remember this scene at 7-Eleven, okay? Playing that drawbridge scene and not knowing what to do on it, okay? Now, people say, no, the drawbridge scene was never in the arcade. You're wrong. Why am I dying there? That's weird. People are saying that the drawbridge scene was not, in fact, in the arcade. And that they removed the ROM, that they never released the ROM that accessed the drawbridge scene. I just don't believe in them, because I clearly played this in the arcade. I don't even know what to do there. And so this enhanced version unlocks this section of the game that was removed by the developers. And again, they removed it because no one could do it and their game would just end. I don't even know what to do. What is the problem here with this one? Okay, so when we come in this room, I gotta go back. I see, and then go right. Okay. Sword. I'm getting better at this. Yay! What do I do? Shit. I can't tell if the picture quality is better, but the game seems to be playing pretty perfect with that new LaserDisc player. So, I'm gonna put the spectator monitor on top. You guys wanna see how that looks? I think that's gonna look pretty cool. Let's see. Let me think about this. I'm gonna put the game back in its home, and then I'll put the spectator monitor on top of it, and all I'm gonna do is I'm just gonna lift it up there. So let's put the game back in its spot and let's check it out with the spectator monitor up top. That's going to be awesome. Oh yeah, one more thing. I got to snake the video cable out the back of this thing. I'm going to go through the air filter. I'm going to actually poke a hole in the air filter. I don't think that's a big deal to you. It seems like the best way to get out. So this is the video cable that we're going to use to plug into the monitor that's going to be on the top of the game. And so I got to get the cord out. Why don't we turn the game off? And I'm just gonna poke a hole through here, through the fiberglass, and just sneak through here. Yeah, no problem. Look at that. That's perfect. All right. Okay, so we can slide this back in now. I guess we'll do that together. Just gotta make sure that everything is in its place and nothing's getting bound up.
On your mark.
Oh, I can't have it that far back. Okay. Boy, it would really suck if I
We gotta push this forward here. It's a little too tight. Like that. See, everything's in the back now instead of on the side. It's a little, it's not tight. There's a little bit of stress on this. I could, it's not tight though. I think it's gonna be all right. I wonder if we can move the player up even further. Not really. I don't want to be up against the filter. I think that's going to be okay. Doesn't really feel like there's too much. No, there's enough slack here. It's not under a lot of pressure. Debating now if I want to spin the player. I don't think so. I think I'm going to leave it like that. Do I want to rotate the player? I don't think there's enough room for the cords. You think about this. All right, guys, we got it in its home, and the monitor's on top, and I think that looks pretty damn cool. What do you guys think? Was it worth the effort? I do think that my LaserDisc player is flaky. I do. I think it's not a very good one. I don't know. It's got something wrong with it. It seems like I need to turn the game on and off a few times. Now, when I moved it back there, it just didn't want to work. It's like you turn the LaserDisc player on, and then the play button flashes, and then it's supposed to like park the disc, and then it starts playing again. But what's happening is sometimes when I turn it on, it never goes to that park. It doesn't like stop the disc. It just starts spinning and spinning and spinning and spinning and spinning, and it's not stopping and then playing. I don't know. I'm going to keep an eye on it. It might be related to when I move things around, but maybe now that it's back in its home, maybe it kind of reset itself. We'll see. I'm going to keep an eye on it. You know, who knows? I might be replacing the LaserDisc player, but I think it looks pretty great. I love that monitor up there. I think it looks really good. The picture on it's good, too. Color on that thing is really good. I wonder if I should use that as a guide, maybe to dial in the bottom one. Bottom one doesn't look bad though. But the top one might look better. What do you think? I don't know. I think it's pretty cool though. I gotta say, I like it. Totally unnecessary, but why not? So, all right guys, that's it for this video. That took a lot longer than I thought it was going to be honest. And I gotta show you something, guys. My Revenge from Mars just died. I shit you not, dude. It just freaking died, and I don't know what's going on. The playfield went out, and I turned the game off immediately. I did replace the fan and the power supply not too long ago. Oh, man, I don't... I gotta work on the journey. I can't be fixing this stuff. Oh, my God, the Revenge from Mars is dead. Ugh. I'm gonna pull it out tomorrow and look at it. I hope it's just the fan or something. I don't know, man. I have no idea. I just turned it off. Not happy. I don't know if it overheated. I don't know. I put a new fan on it, though. And a new power supply. Turn it back on and see what happens. Yeah, see, it's not... The computer's not turning on. Computer's off. Dark. Yeah, the computer's not booting. Oh man, I can't win. I hope it's just the power supply. Maybe I got a crappy new power supply. Who knows? All right, guys, that's it. So did you enjoy that? You know, I release new videos every Sunday and sometimes in between. I cannot believe Revenge from Mars just died. Honestly, I am not in the mood for that right now. I got enough crap going on. I don't want to screw around with this pinball machine right now. Anyway, I release new videos on Sunday and sometimes in between. If you guys have never subscribed to my channel, now is a good time to subscribe. Because if you do, you can keep up with all my awesome videos. You know, we go on road trips, we fix things, you know, we visit friends. It's never-ending arcade fun on John's Arcade. So if you want to keep up, if you want to see this stuff,
you gotta click subscribe. And then also check out my two podcasts. One's called Arcade Outsiders at arcadeoutsiders.com. The other is Video Game Outsiders at videogameoutsiders.com. We do both of those shows live every Tuesday at allgames.com starting at 9 p.m. Eastern. Or during the week, go to iTunes and Stitcher and do a search for Video Game Outsiders or Arcade Outsiders. Anyway, all right, guys, that's going to do it for this video. And I'll see you guys later. Later, and bye. And yeah, that looks really cool up there. Later, guys. Bye.